Jesus, we come before you tonight, and we just want to sanctify this service. Which means, God, we want this to be different than anything we've done today, different than any other activity or interaction that we've had. We want this to be not as much an interaction between us as it is an interaction between you and us. For God, we have gathered in your name. God, you said you would be here. And if you're here, then God, the agenda is yours. God, everything in the service belongs to you. As they say, the floor is yours, God. You speak, you move, you do what you see fit, dear God. We have ideas and we have plans, dear God, but they do not supersede yours, dear God. They come under your influence. And we ask you, oh God, to in every heart, in every aspect of the service, may the name of Jesus be glorified and may the kingdom of God be built in us. That God, we may be what you have called us to be. We may be strong. We may be holy. We may be truly the saved of God. For that is not our own effort. That is your power at work within us. So God, this is a holy time. It's a special time. And dear God, we give it to you and we honor it in that regard. And so, Father, with open minds and open hearts, we give ourselves to you afresh and anew. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to sing Acapella again tonight. How about that? Have you been to Jesus or are you washed in the blood? Amen. Yeah, let's do right on that first verse. Have you been to Jesus for that cleansing fire? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood?
Are you washed?
are in our midst. Let me give you a praise report. Lee's with her dad tonight, and he went to the heart doctor today. He had gained about 10 pounds of fluid since the surgery, so they upped his medicine, and that has been taken care of now. Good report. Other than that, sling's a little high. They adjusted it a little. But he's going to be not driving for the next 4 weeks. So I don't know if we should pray for his body or his patience, because not being able to go and do as he regularly does, that's going to be the challenge, even more than the physical challenges that he's facing. So please keep lifting him up in prayer.
Go ahead. I never get to see the signs and wonders. If the miracles I pray for never came, there would be no cause to doubt the love of Jesus. Cause his love for me is faithful just the same. The cross is all the proof I need. The nails of blood he'll call Calvary. No greater love was given than this, so I believe. The cross is all the proof I need. I am blessed beyond what I could have. Finds me everywhere I go. But if I walk the road of tragedy and sorrow, I will still sing, Jesus lost me, this I know.
Earth, O Lord, is full of thy mercy. Teach me thy statutes. So the first thing that really stuck out to me in this, and that I kind of kept thinking about, was what does portion mean, like, to the writer of the song? And I looked it up on Google, of course, and the archaic definition of fortune, and I thought it was really interesting, there's actually two definitions. And the first one is a future, a person's future as allotted by fate, one's destiny or lot. And then the second one is a dowry given to a bride at her marriage. So I thought that both of those were really important, because if we think about it, that's what God is for us. God is our future. He's our allotted, he's our allot by faith. And he's also our dowry. Because when this life eventually ends, that's what we go into. And then I thought it was interesting that it says, the bands of the wicked have robbed me, but I have not forgotten thy law. And that got me thinking a lot about that. What do we do when something happens to us that we didn't expect? When something that we were wanting to happen that nobody expected to happen, when the devil comes after us and he does the one thing that we thought would never happen to us. And it says that I have not forgotten thy law. And that's something that I think a lot of us all pray to, is when things don't go the way we wanted them to, or when we pray to God and ask for something to happen and he doesn't do it exactly the way we were wanting it done, that do we forget what he told us? Or do we cling to what he told us and continue to follow in his words and his steps and be faithful unto God as he is to us? Because even though we think he's not being faithful to us because it wasn't done the way that we wanted it done, he is. He's always faithful.
Yes.
And the immediate verse after that is, at midnight I will rise to give thanks unto thee because of thy righteous judgments. And in my Bible, it has a little asterisk with it, and it references to Acts 16:25. And I don't know how many of y'all are familiar with that, but I had to go back and read that again. And that is where Paul and Silas are literally prostrate, praying all night long to God, desperately, until finally they're released from prison. The walls finally just fall. And I thought it interesting that those two verses follow each other, because that's what we're called to do. That's what we're meant to do. That's what we're told to do. When something happens, good, bad, whatever, we are supposed to call out to Jesus, call out to God, and just lay everything out before him and cling to him as closely as we possibly can until we are freed. And it says, the earth is full of thy mercy, and teach me thy statutes. And I thought that one was important, because we lose sight of the fact that is, despite everything that's going on around us and in this world, because he sent Jesus for us, the entire earth can be covered by grace and his mercy. Because he literally came to teach us what to do, how to live, how to pray, how to have a relationship with God, so that when this earth ends, we don't have to face the depths of hell and sin forever. So the entire earth is full of his mercy, simply because he came, he did it. He went to the cross and he overcame sin and death for us, so that we can have that forever. And I just thought that those things were really important, because I've had a lot of things, even though I'm dealing, I've had things happen to me that I questioned why they happened, and I didn't want to look at what God said or what God was trying to do with my life or anything like that. Like, I just recently lost my father. My father was 50. It was completely unexpected. Should not have happened. And I struggled really hard, and I still do, with God, why would you do that to me? Why would you take him from me? Because I had such a close relationship with my father. And I came to realize that he didn't take him from me. He took him to be with him. Because my dad's journey was over. He had done everything. Even though I feel like there was more he could have done. He's not here to see his granddaughter, you know, certain things. God is still there for me. And regardless of that, my dad is still with me, because the things that he taught me about God and how to live and how to treat people and everything, that is still with me. So I thought that that was something that really spoke to me, because I know I've had a hard time with remembering God's word and clinging to God rather than wanting to try to do things myself. And it just reminded me that we're not meant to do things on our own. Yes, the Lord gives us what we can handle, but he also tells us, you're meant to handle it with me, Habibi. You're not meant to handle it by yourself. So I've always found it interesting when people say, well, God doesn't give you more than you can handle. God doesn't give you more than you can handle with his help. He doesn't expect you to try to do it by yourself. He expects you to ask him for help. And if we can just remember to do that, to ask him for help, no matter what it is, he doesn't care what it is. He already knows before you ask him that you need help with it. He just wants you to love him like you would your earthly father and mother. And if you need help, ask him. That's all you have to do, and he'll be there for you. So that's just what I feel like that particular part was saying to me, was that, you know, if you need something, turn to other children of God and turn to me, because I will be there for you, and I will help you with whatever you need. I already have it taken care of before you even asked me. But I still want you to ask. As my daughter, I want you to come to me. I want you to be in that relationship with me, that if you are hurting or you're in need of something, that I am where you turn. And so I just think that that's what he's really trying to tell us in this part, to come and ask him for anything. It doesn't matter how small or how big or anything. Just turn to him, pray about it, and ask him to help you with whatever you're going through. And that's all he wants.
I'm amazed. I don't know if you've been, as we've read through Psalm 119, always assume that it is true that this is about the love of God's word. And it is. It is about the love of God's word. But it's not like it's a thing unto itself. It's always in connection with God. It's not, I don't have a relationship with the word of God. I have a relationship with God, and through his word is that how that interaction takes place. So like you were saying, that portion, what is the first words that he says? The Lord is my portion. Talked about several different ways it has been used in centuries. There's yet another way that's used as well. Tied to those, that's why they certainly use that word. Whenever inheritances were given out, portions were given out. And firstborn got double. Everybody else got what was left over. He's saying, Lord, you are my portion. So what does he ultimately want out of this world? He wants just more of the Lord. And that provoked a thought in me as well, Miss Haley, about our relationship with God and what our companions and closest associates, who are they? Think about it in general. Who are the people closest to you?
God.
But God can't be like our family. We can't sit down and have a meal with him. We can't go to the shop with him. We can't interact with him like we do other people. And what comes natural for us is interaction with other people. So it's natural for us. But it was natural for the psalmist too. It's natural for him to interact with other people. But he said, Lord, you are my portion. You could say, in addition to what we've heard, you're also my inheritance. You're what I want. So his companions that he's chosen most of all, what he wants more than anything else, and he could have said, Lord, I thank you for my family, for my co-workers, for those that spiritually grow like me. But he said, it's about you, Lord. You, Lord, are the portion that I'm looking for. You are what matters to me. And this is all about companionship. It's all about who we have going along with us on the journey of life. Who is it? Because family has an opinion. Are they always right?
No.
I'm always right when I'm telling my kids. But you never think I'm wrong. Even if I am, I'm still right. But seriously. Good. Are friends always right? Church people always right? Ooh, we even got to go there. Are pastors always right? So, if the Bible's true, this goes beyond the psalm, but the psalm says, can two walk together except they be agreed? Bible says that who we associate with affects us. Of course it does. Even if we know our friends are wrong sometimes, they still have an influence on us, a heavy one. Our family still has a heavy influence on us. Even though we know they're not perfect. They do, because that's natural. But here's where we've got to stop for a moment and think. Who should be our closest confidant? Who should be the one that has the most influence over us? Oh, that's an easy question, preacher. Of course, it's God. Then who do you ask for advice first? Who do you ask for an opinion first? Before you think about the latest issue of the day, and there's plenty of them here, we're in election year, whose opinion do you want first? We don't always ask the Lord first. We always deal with stuff, and then we say, Lord, could you help me out here? I'm stuck. He started off, Lord, you are my portion. I want you to look at several different things here that talks about this. He talks about his companions here. He first starts with the Lord here, and then he says that there are other companions, like in verse 61, which was mentioned as well. The cords of the wicked. Where does the cords come from? It doesn't come from the wicked ground or the wicked building or the wicked sky. Where does the cords of the wicked come from? It comes from ultimately the devil, but I don't think the devil is visiting the psalmist's house. Sitting down in his bed throwing cords over it. Who is laying out the cords of the wicked? The wicked. And the wicked can be anybody around you. Because the cords of the wicked are those things that bind you, that tie you, that pull you in a wicked direction. Can family get in between you and God? Can friends get in between you and God? Can church get in between you and God? Oh, yes. So these things can be of great help, but they can also be a great hindrance. Therefore, who comes first? Who gets the greatest loyalty? If somebody's got to be put on hold, who is it? The psalmist said, you are my portion, even though I've got a family. You are my portion, even though I've got friends. You are my portion, even though I gather at the temple with others. Lord, you are my portion. And you need that because we can't handle everything on our own. We can't. Try. And that'll be one of those things you remember as a failure in your life. We've all got them. When we did it, we failed at it. God meant for us to lean on Him. So when the cords of wicked come to us, it's either temptation or persecution. Both are doing the same thing, trying to weaken our faith and pull us away from God. But what was the answer Ms. Haley shared with us? What did he do about those times when he finds the cords around him and he realizes that's happened to him? I have not forgotten your law. Now there's a good little sermon in there. If you don't know it, then you're going to have trouble not forgetting it. You got to know it and then not forget it. He already knows it. Therefore, when the cords surround him, he says, I know what's happening. I know the pressure being put on me. I know what you're trying to do. But I have not forgotten his truth. And if he's more important than whoever these are around him, then he's going to stick with what he said rather than what the others said. That's how you take temptation. That's how. Think about Joseph's temptation. That's a famous one. He's tempted. Very much tempted for a single guy. That is probably like the worst temptation for a single guy in somebody else's servitude. But what got him through that temptation? Not, oh, I shouldn't have done that. I'll know better next time. No, he knew better the first time. How can I do this to God? How can I do this to my master? Where did he learn that stuff from? It's the truth of God gave him the strength when the cords of temptation of the wicked were around him. He had an answer. If he didn't have that word, where would he be? That's the same problem people are facing every day. They don't know the truth, so they're getting into a mess they didn't know was coming. They didn't realize it would turn out that way. They didn't realize it would blow up in their face. That's because they didn't know the truth. Or for some, they didn't know it. But they just said, well, I'm smarter. My peers are smarter. My culture is smarter than all that old truth you were sharing. Well, old truths are stubborn. They hang around when all the lies show them, show their identity. They hang with us. They're there for a reason. They've endured the test of time. They are there. So when those companions, you're able to get out because of the truth of God's law. But he mentions other companions too in verse 63. These are the ones he chose. You can't control the cords come about you, but you can control these. I am a companion. What does it say, church? Say it together. All who fear you. So what you doing hanging around with God, Aish? Why are you letting people influence your life? Why are you giving them your hours, your time? Is there truth out in the world? Yes. Not all Christians are, not all scientists are Christians. Not all good people, so to speak, are Christians. There's some truth out there. But who we give ourselves to be influenced by is a very important thing. He says, I've made a choice. I'm going to hang out with people. It's going to be people that fear you. People that trust you. People that know you. That kind of goes hand in hand, doesn't it? That's why we have a problem where we're teaching our kids just as hard as we can and then we send them to college. What happens? I see your faces. You know what happens. They're not around church folk anymore. Nobody's making them go to church. So they're in these nice secular institutions that teach them what? How to live like the world. And it breaks your heart because all those years you've invested seems to be undone. It matters who your companions are. You can't always control who you work with. Steve, don't get better, I promise. Just kidding. pick on me, so I got a platform I can pick on. Yeah, she did run you off dinner, so she's a smart lady. You can't always control who's in your family or who's in your club or whatever. And I'm not saying, Paul didn't say you should be taken out of the world. He didn't say that. He just said, don't be in the world. Let me say it clearly. Don't be of the world. You're in it, don't be of it. Don't be like it. And in fact, he says again, come out from among them and be separate. What does that mean anymore for the Christian church? I don't think it means we totally divorce ourselves from the world. I think the world's in a greater mess because we haven't exerted enough influence on it. But they should be influencing us. They should have it. There should be a line around our lives that says, okay, you can't go any further. You cannot control me. You cannot influence me to that point. I will let you. I will be a companion of those who fear God and those who keep their precepts. So I'd like to ask all those who by choice, not by act of life, but by choice say, I don't need to come to church. I'm fine by myself. If your companion's a TV preacher, I feel so sorry for you. Because I promise you, he doesn't have a lot of influence over you. I promise you, he doesn't. The moment he says something you don't like, click. He is out of your life in an instant. You can't shut me up if you want to. There's got to be an amen for you to leave. I'm jesting again, but I'm trying to point a point. We need each other. We need to choose our companions, and the companions that we need are those that fear God, those who keep your precepts, not those who talk a good game. There's plenty of them out there. I honestly thank God that it's not popular to be a Christian anymore. I don't like the world the way it is, but I don't like people who just did it so they could get influence. I know there's churches, and it probably still happens to some degree in the South, people go to church and get into that field just as though it helps them in business or helps them make connections that they need in life. The church is not about making connections unless it's a connection to God. So I'm glad it's popular to be somewhere else. And it's out of style to be in church because those that are in church, they're going to be serious. They're here for God and for no other reason. Those who actually want to follow this life and not want to play pretend that. Our companions matter. They truly do in life. Notice, I want to notice that part about as well, is his interaction with God. I'm just going to list these because Haley mentioned some of them, but he talks about God in very personal ways. You're my inheritance, you're my portion, he said. I have sought you, I have turned towards you, I have not forgotten your law, I give thanks to you, I'm with those who follow you, and you are everywhere. The earth is full of your loving kindness, so teach me. This is a whole lot about God. It's a whole lot about him in every part of his life. I don't believe I'm talking to anybody here, but if we have an opportunity to tell somebody church is more than just 10 to 11, I think we ought to tell them. It's more than just about coming for an hour. It's even more than just about coming to women's and men's ministry. It's about being engaged and involved. It's about seeing God at work in our lives. And all these things are here to support that, not to just give us something to do. Who's not busy right now? I mean, hello? We're all busy. But some things are so important. We can't miss them. We need them. They are important to us. Now, I'm going to wrap this up and give you time to ask or do something yourself. But there's two prayers. I thought that was notable. Only two prayers in these seven verses. What are those two prayers? It's a lot of declarations. But he's only asked for two things. So I think that's kind of important. You go, 58. Be merciful or gracious to me. See, this is a two-way street. You ought to ask God for grace. You ought to ask God to help us through our day. God, forgive me for the days that I get up and I go about my business and I haven't even talked to you. Boy, I assumed a lot, didn't I? There's a whole lot of breaths I assumed I would have. There's a whole lot of steps I assumed I would have. There's a whole lot of actions I assumed that I will have. Until I hear this tragic story about somebody who died when they weren't supposed to. I told you about one Sunday. My backdoor neighbor. He went to sleep one night. Next day, didn't wake up. I wonder how many breaths he thought he would have when he went to sleep. When he retired. Think about it. Wonder how many years he thought he had left. that kind of shocks you for a minute. God, how many days am I assuming I have? God, how many actions do I assume I have? I ought to be seeking your mercy, your grace, daily, constantly, and in everything, because this is a two-way street. The straight and narrow, anybody tried to do it on their own efforts? The Pharisees did, and they failed. The church has tried to make a whole page list of rules that nobody could follow. We failed. Try to do it in our efforts. But Jesus never said we had to walk the straight and narrow by ourselves. He would walk with us. So ask for His grace. Ask for His help. Ask for His strength through whatever is in front of you. That's His first prayer. What's His second prayer? Teach. Teach. Beverly's out of here. That's what, spoiler alert, that's what I'm going to be talking about Sunday with the kids. Can we still learn from God? I think we should. I love that it's connected to the earth is full of your loving kindness. The earth is full of your mercy. I like that word loving kindness because it's not just He's acting lovingly toward me. He's being kind to me and loving. Putting those two things together. Because I just think they convey different things. Love and kindness. You know, you can love and never show it. But kindness, you got to do something to be kind to somebody. God does that for us. Every day, God has shown us His love. I said this Sunday too. Even in the midst of all this COVID mess, isn't the day still good? Isn't it still blessed? We sing these songs, and boy, we had some anointed singing Sunday, Brother Jimmy. Goodness, I felt the Lord in a powerful way.
Amen.
It's a good day. You can do it in yourself. You can have a happy little time in your cars, friend. You can have a happy little time in your kitchen. It's okay. It's still good. Because His loving kindness is everywhere. It's everywhere. I bet you can find it. I bet you can find it in the woods. I bet you can find it under a dock. I bet you can go anywhere, and about anywhere in this world, and you can find God's loving kindness there. So if He's everywhere, and He's so good, and He's so kind, how about teach me, Lord? Teach me not to just look through my own eyes, because I'll tend to look at what's helpful to me, or selfishly I will look. Teach me your ways, your statutes, what matters to you. He sends those beautiful little birds out my window. I put the bird feeder out there. They show up, and I've seen different ones all the time. They even say, well, that's just birds wanting food. But I enjoy it. And they're different. They're not the same ones every time. So why am I getting different birds? You can have your explanation. Here's mine. God loves me. His loving kindness is even outside my window. Now they're kind of slacked off. It's bird feeders. But I can see God's loving kindness even in the simple things, and I think it's there. So then teach me that. Is God teaching you something? Have you learned a lesson that way? God teaching you about His loving kindness? The Lord is my portion. I have promised to keep your words. The last verse, the earth is full of your loving kindness, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. Just a beautiful way. And I want that to matter to you as you go throughout the rest of this week. This is what we think about. Is we're studying about the word is, but it's really all about Him. I want to be a part of everything you do.